Welcome to part 4A in the Rapture and Wrath Ready or Not video series. In this episode, I'll be explaining the events of Revelation chapter 8. When the seventh and final seal is opened on the scroll, heaven will be absolutely silent for the space of half an hour. It is the sobering realization in heaven that God is about to go to war on earth that will initiate the silence. In the previous episode, we looked at two major events that will take place just prior to the day of the Lord, which is the outpouring of God's wrath. First, 144,000 Jews are sealed for protection. Second, a great multitude, which is the raptured church, is caught up to meet the Lord in the clouds. The 144,000 sealed and protected servants of God, which are comprised of 12,000 Jews from each of the 12 tribes of Israel, will remain on the earth and be protected by God during the time of His wrath. They will take the gospel of Christ to the world and will be the first fruits of a great harvest of Jews and Gentiles who come to faith in Christ and enter His millennial kingdom in mortal bodies. The second group the Apostle John sees is even larger than the first, so large that it was impossible to number. This great multitude is comprised of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, which are languages. They're seen standing in heaven before the throne and before the Lamb with palm branches in their hands. John is told that these are they who have come out of great tribulation and have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ. But this great multitude isn't silent. They're singing a psalm of praise to the Lord with a loud voice, saying, "Salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb." When this great multitude suddenly appears in heaven, all the angels, elders, and living creatures are there to joyously greet them. But as I explained in the previous episode, we don't see the church listed as part of the greeting committee in heaven because this great multitude just arriving is the resurrected and raptured church. I went on to say that in Matthew chapter 24, which is a parallel passage to Revelation 6 and 7, the Lord Himself identifies this great multitude as His elect. But now the eighth chapter of the book of Revelation begins, and it does so with a startling statement. John wrote, "And when He, Jesus, had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour." In the previous chapter, John spoke in glowing terms of a great multitude in heaven, crying with a loud voice, saying, "Salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb." He also spoke of angels, elders, and living creatures who were worshiping God and saying, "Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. Amen." Heaven itself was alive with the sound of music. And then, without any warning or transition, John suddenly speaks of silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. What caused the great multitude in heaven to instantly turn from singing to silence? A careful search for the cause of this dramatic change can be seen in the words of the prophet Zephaniah. He wrote, "Hold thy peace," or be silent, "at the presence of the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is at hand, for the Lord hath prepared a sacrifice. He hath bid His guests." The prophet made three important observations, all of which are directly related to the call for silence in Revelation chapter 8. First, the prophet commanded, "Hold thy peace, be silent, at the presence of the Lord God." Second, he linked his call for silence to the start of the day of the Lord. He said, "For the day of the Lord is at hand," which means that it is about to begin. This fact is critically important for our discussion here, as it gives us a clear indication that none of the events which have preceded Revelation 8 are part of God's wrath. Based on the parallel between Zephaniah's prophetic words and Revelation 8:1, we can clearly see the start of God's wrath has not yet come. It is about to begin. Look again at the important sequence of the seals. When the Son of God opens the sixth seal, there will be cosmic disturbance. Something will happen to the sun, moon, and stars. The sun will be darkened, the moon will not give her light, and the stars will fall from heaven. Cosmic disturbance, which is mentioned consistently throughout Scripture, is the clear and obvious indicator that the day of the Lord is about to begin. And now, with the breaking of the seventh seal in Revelation 8:1, the day of the Lord will begin. The scroll, no longer bound by the seals, will be rolled open as the trumpets are blown, and the Lord Jesus Christ will begin his return to earth as the conquering king. It is the realization in heaven of the horrific judgment that is about to occur on earth with the blowing of the seven trumpets which initiates the silence. Apart from the crucifixion of the Son of God, it is impossible to envision a more somber event in the annals of history. No wonder heaven will be silent. Third, Zephaniah made clear who the recipients of this judgment will be. He said, "For the Lord hath prepared a sacrifice. He hath bid his guests." The prophet's words are dripping with sarcasm. The Bible is precise in stating believers will not be among the invited guests to the day of the Lord. This is the time of God's wrath, and believers are not appointed to God's wrath. The Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Thessalonians 1:10, "And to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered or delivers us from the wrath to come." And again in 1 Thessalonians 5:9, in a context where he was discussing the day of the Lord, he wrote, "For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation or deliverance by our Lord Jesus Christ." Believers will be raptured immediately prior to the opening of the seventh seal, which initiates the wrath of God. It will be a pre-wrath rapture of the church. The sacrifice to which the prophet refers is those who will be slain during the day of the Lord, when God's holiness will be vindicated before his creation. God's invited guests on that occasion will be those who rejected his grace, refused his mercy, and spurned his love. They will be sinners in the hands of an angry God. It's hard for many Christians to get comfortable with the truth of God's wrath. We're more at home in speaking of the love of God, of turning the other cheek, and of little Jesus, meek and mild. Yet I remind you that God's love cannot embrace what his holiness condemns. God's attributes work in harmony. We can't pick and choose the ones we like and discard the rest. If God is holy, he must judge sin. In the ultimate sense, God's judgment will come during the day of the Lord. John wrote, "And I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets." Judgment of the earth is now at the very portal of heaven. But first, for a moment, words of prayer must come. "And another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense, which came with the prayers of the saints, ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. And the angel took the censer, and filled it with fire of the altar, and cast it into the earth. And there were voices, and thunderings, and lightnings, and an earthquake." The prayers of the saints refer to the prayers of the great multitude in heaven. Following the breaking of the sixth seal, they were raptured and glorified, and are now serving in God's temple. The church is praying the Lord Jesus Christ will now begin to judge the earth. Theirs is not a vindictive or insensitive prayer. It is a prayer for the triumph of the Lord Jesus Christ. In a sense, it is the prayer believers have prayed through the centuries, perhaps without full understanding, when they voiced the words, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven." There can be no victorious king or righteous kingdom without the defeat of Satan. The earth has been contaminated by sin since the fall of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. Wickedness, evil, perversion, murder, lying, cheating, greed, war, bigotry, hatred, transgression, disobedience, natural catastrophe, idolatry, and corruption. It's quite a list. These are some of the dreadful consequences of sin since it entered the human experience. Satan, who solicited Adam and Eve to sin, heads an ordered world system which stands in opposition to God. His desire from the beginning has been to supersede man and rule the earth. Satan has an antichrist, a false prophet, demons, fallen angels, counterfeit religionists, corrupt governments, pagans, idolaters, wicked and godless men, an army of immense size and power to implement his wicked strategies. Sometimes Satan, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour, and sometimes he goes about as an angel of light. To deny his existence, ignore the threat he poses to the soul, disregard his subtle devices, and be naive regarding his influence in the world is the height of foolishness. If for a moment the curtain was pulled back and we were permitted to see the spiritual conflict raging all around us, we would be paralyzed by fear. The heavens, the oceans, the rivers, the mountains and valleys, the plains and all of life, everything over which man was given dominion, have been corrupted by sin brought about by Satan. When Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world," he was not saying he would not one day rule over the earth, as some have inaccurately suggested. He was saying he would not rule over this corrupted earth until it is purged of all that has defiled it. When the Apostle Peter wrote of new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells, he wasn't speaking of a new heaven in the sense of origin. He was speaking of a new heaven in the sense of quality. The Greek word kainos that's used for the word new here in the translation of Peter's text bears this out. The new heavens and new earth of which Peter spoke are the same heavens and earth that now exist. But during the day of the Lord, God will purge them of all vestiges of sin, and they will be qualitatively new. The same can be said of a believer, who upon accepting Christ as Savior becomes a new creation. They are the same person, but because their sin has been imputed to Christ and Christ's righteousness has been imputed to them, they are a new creation qualitatively. So now, in revisiting the heavenly scene, we see the great multitude in heaven, the resurrected and raptured church, praying for the ultimate triumph of the Lord Jesus Christ. But in this magnificent gathering of glorified believers of all the ages is not praying for God's wrath to be poured out on a wicked world because it will be pleasant, but because it is just and necessary. The glorified church in heaven understands the righteous kingdom of Jesus Christ cannot be established before the world is purged and Satan is defeated. Without the purging of the earth, there can be no restitution or restoration of all things. Without the purging of the earth, there can be no triumph of Christ over Satan. Only after the earth is purified of all that has defiled it will Jesus Christ establish his millennial 1,000-year kingdom and bring true and lasting peace to our planet. Thank you for watching. In the next episode of this series, part 4b, we'll discuss the trumpet judgments of Revelation chapters 8 and 9. Sound the battle cry. Everything is ready, and the time has come for the Son of God to go to war on earth.
Go deeper in your understanding of God, His people, and His plan for planet Earth. Zion's Fire magazine is an exceptional resource with powerful insights from Scripture that provide a clear understanding of God's ultimate plan for the last days and the return of Jesus Christ. As a first-time subscriber, you'll receive a free one-year subscription to Zion's Fire magazine with no strings attached. Request your free subscription by visiting our website or by calling our toll-free number, and we'll send you 6 free issues, one every other month, for a full year. We depend on the generosity of viewers like you to support the ongoing production of these programs. Your donation, whether large or small, is greatly appreciated. Donations may be given online at www.zionshope.org or by calling us toll-free at 1-888-781-9466. Stay informed and see the latest from Zion's Hope by liking us on Facebook, subscribing to our YouTube channel, and following us on Twitter.